Now, I just want to share with you something really cool. We've been studying about the Jewish feasts, kind of our Jewish backgrounds as believers in Jesus. And you know, the early church, all the first Christians were Jewish, weren't they? I was just talking to one of the world messianic leaders. I mean, he is world renowned. And I was talking to another person. I don't know if I'm supposed to say who they are. But yeah, he's the director of the Billy Graham Evangelistic Association. He was saying, and he's Jewish, and the Lord saved him. And he said, you know, I didn't really feel like this big change. He said, what I felt was completion. Like, this is really who I am. This is where the Old Testament goes. It goes right into the New Testament. And I feel like I was completed. And so if we look at the New Testament in the light of the Old, we'll see some very beautiful things. Now, just a word. We do not interpret the New Testament. The New Testament interprets the Old Testament. That's what I want to say, lest we become confused and we think that the Old Testament directs us. It doesn't, but it does shine a light on Jesus. And somebody was telling me this week how at a meeting of their coworkers, because of the things that they have learned about these messianic and Old Testament teachings, they were able to share with over 50 of their coworkers this week the gospel using some of the things that we have taught. It came up, they asked them, what do you think about? And they were just given grace, and like I said, in 15 minutes shared with 50 people, shared the gospel, and they were in rapt attention because they weren't talking necessarily about the cross, but they were coming through Jewish symbols, but they were presenting the gospel, and it was just an awesome opportunity to do that. Isn't that cool? I'd like for you to open your Bibles to Daniel, the book of Daniel, the prophet, chapter 11. Daniel chapter 11, just hold your place there. You know, every year as we are preparing to celebrate Christmas, which will not be but a few weeks from now, isn't that crazy? Jewish people around the world are also preparing to celebrate a wonderful holiday. It's called Hanukkah. And it may surprise you, but this holiday is mentioned in the Bible, and Jesus observed it. And we're going to look at more about that next week. We're going to look at how Jesus observed and what happened on during the festival of Hanukkah. But maybe you didn't know that. He was a part of that culture, of course. It wasn't one of the holy days that God commanded his people to observe. It wasn't like Passover, unleavened bread, or first fruits, or Pentecost, or trumpets, or Day of Atonement, or the Feast of Tabernacles. It wasn't one of those. It wasn't a pilgrimage feast. You didn't have to go to Jerusalem. But the history of this festival isn't in the Bible. The history is clearly documented, though. References of it are found in what we call the Apocrypha, in the book of 1 and 2 Maccabees. There they contain the historical record of Hanukkah. How do you spell Hanukkah? H-A-N-U-K-K-A-H, depending on how you spell it. Okay, it's spelled different ways. There are about 15 books in the of the Old Testament Apocrypha, and they're a collection of non-inspired Jewish writings written from between 200 B.C. to about A.D. 100. And so the Apocrypha are not inspired books, but you'll see them sometime included in some Bibles between the book of Malachi and the book of Matthew. Have anybody ever noticed those books and wondered what they're all about? They're not inspired. The Jews who put together the Old Testament canon did not consider them inspired, but they didn't want to throw them away either because they're great history. And so as historical documents, they're great. Not inspired, but we're going to look at some of what they have to say. So do you understand? We're looking at history. Happens to be in the Apocrypha. And by the way, I was looking at an original facsimile. An original facsimile. a facsimile of the original King James Version Bible. And in the Bible, between the Old and New Testaments, they have these same apocryphal books. So Christians, going way back to the King James Bible, they understood that these books are great for history, though they are not what? Inspired. Okay. So let's talk about the origin of Hanukkah. After returning from the exile in Babylon in 536 BC, the Jewish people rededicated themselves to the Lord and they rebuilt the temple. Those events are talked about in the books of Ezra and Nehemiah. Yet they remained vulnerable to the control of foreign powers. They never really ruled themselves ever again, and including the Greeks and the Syrians. Now, under the rule of Alexander the Great, the Jewish people were treated favorably, and we're told that Alexander came to Jerusalem, and the whole agenda of the Greeks was to push their culture throughout the world, to make the world more like Greece, you know, and it would be a more modern, hospitable place. And so the intent was to come to Jerusalem to do that, but Alexander met the high priest, and he was so impressed with the beauty and the splendor and the reverence of the temple and the worship that occurred there that he gave religious freedom to the Jews, and he even canceled Jewish taxes, the Greek taxes on the Jews during the sabbatical year. So, I mean, talk about a great government, right? So every 7 years, you didn't have to pay taxes. Most importantly, he decided not to impose the Greek culture on them, and he allowed Jerusalem to be the only place where statues would not be erected to Greek gods. However, it was during the Syrian rule over Israel that the Jewish people were subject to great persecution. In 168 BC, Antiochus Epiphanes, an evil Syrian general, invaded Israel and he captured Jerusalem and he desecrated the temple and he proclaimed an end to the Jewish religion. So we're going to look at this a little more in depth. His name is Antiochus Epiphanes. Can you say that? Antiochus Epiphanes. Epiphanes wasn't his last name, it was the title he gave himself. Epiphanes means manifest God. And so, you know, he had no self-esteem issues, did he? He wanted people to consider him as a god, but behind his back, people would call him Antiochus Epimenes, which meant the lunatic. Antiochus Epiphanes invaded Israel, Judah, with the intention of forcing Greek culture on the Jewish people. He demanded that they only speak Greek, and he outlawed speaking Hebrew to children, and they were only to be taught Greek culture. Yohanan, the brother of Onias, the high priest, who was a righteous man, he changed his name to the Greek name of Jason and wanted to move toward Hellenization. So you had a sitting high priest, a godly man, and his brother who was not the high priest. But Jason, the ungodly brother, he offered a bribe to Antiochus for the office of high priest. He promised that if Antiochus would give him the high priestly office, he would build a temple to the Greek god Phallus, need I say more, and a gymnasium that the Jews found offensive because there in the gymnasium, people would exercise naked and in a Greek gym, and that was offensive to Jewish law. And homosexuality was practiced there, and often child molestation occurred. I've done a study on the gymnasium, as it is in Greek, and parents were always worried about their kids going to this place because there were predators everywhere. As a further insult, he constructed one large gymnasium at the base of the Temple Mount. Those of you who have been, how many have been to Israel? Let me see. A few of you. tons of us, okay? But you know, there at the Temple Mount steps, at the base of the southern steps there, just south of that, they have found remains of this gymnasium that was built just as an insult to the people of Israel. And Tychicus was happy to consent to this, and so he accepted the bride, and Jason had assassins kill his righteous brother, Yohanan, and Jason became the high priest. This was shocking to everybody because never before had any outsider ever tampered with the priesthood. 3 years later, Menelaus, a strong supporter of Hellenism, offered an even bigger bribe to Antiochus. And he was not a member of the priestly family, so this is the first time that there's a possibility of a non-Aaronic family having the holy priesthood. And so Antiochus accepted the bribe, but when he discovered that the bribe he had offered Antiochus, there was not enough money to pay that bribe in the temple treasury, what he did was he stole the holy vessels, the golden vessels from the temple, and he paid his debt to Antiochus with those. Now begins the reign of terror. Kevin L. Howard writes, and I just feel like he writes it as well as anyone would, so let me share it with you. He writes, "Dark days followed, filled with terror and persecution. The faithful immediately fled to the wilderness or to the Judean hills to live in caves, but they were hunted like animals. During that time of intense suffering, thousands sacrificed their lives to remain true to their God. Jewish history records several such heroic acts of faithful devotion. Eleazar, 90 years of age, and one of the principal scribes, that's one who is skilled in the science of handwriting the scriptures, he was brought before Antiochus and commanded to eat swine's flesh. He refused to defile himself and break the law of God. So the soldiers asked him to bring his own lawful meat and eat it as if it were the detestable pork. After an eloquent statement of faith, he remained unmoved, not willing to deceive the young people with his example." So you say, well, just eat the clean food, you can eat it, but they'll think that you're eating the pork anyway. And he says, I don't want to corrupt the young people thinking that I, one of their elders, would do this. And so with that, the soldiers beat him mercilessly until he died. Another account relates the enduring courage of a woman named Hannah and her 7 sons. They too were arrested and compelled to eat swine's flesh and thereby assent to the pagan sacrifice. One by one, the sons were tortured, and when they refused to yield, they were boiled alive in cauldrons. When one son was approached to apostatize or have his tongue and hands cut off, he courageously testified, "These I had from heaven, and for his laws I despise them, and from him I hope to receive them again." Another affirmed before he died, "It is good being put to death by men to look for hope from God and to be raised up by him again." As the last son was pressed to deliver himself by apostatizing, his mother encouraged him with the resurrection. Listen to what she says. She says, "But doubtless the creator of the world, who formed the generation of man and found out the beginning of all things, will also of his own mercy give you breath and life again. Fear not this tormentor, but being worthy of thy brethren, take thy death, that I may receive thee again in mercy with thy brethren." She's encouraging him with the hope of the resurrection, right? And all these brothers, they all had the hope of the resurrection. Okay, kill me, I'll lay down my life for what is right, and I'll honor the true and living God. Finally, the mother was put to death because all steadfastly refused deliverance in hope of the resurrection. You know, the book of Hebrews mentions these people. The book of Hebrews mentions people. Listen to what it says in Hebrews 11:35. These are people who would not capitulate to Antiochus' demands. It says, "And others were tortured, not accepting their release, so that they might obtain a better resurrection. And others experienced mockings and scourgings, yes, also chains and imprisonment. They were stoned, they were sawn in two. They were tempted, and they were put to death with the sword. They went about in sheepskins, in goatskins, being destitute, afflicted, ill-treated, men of whom the world was not worthy, wandering in deserts and mountains and caves and holes in the ground. And all these, having gained approval through their faith, did not receive what was promised, because God had provided something better for us, so that apart from us, they would not be made perfect. So the book of Hebrews there at the very end of chapter 11 is talking about these people that we don't have recorded in the Bible. But we do see and understand that the people there in that intertestamental period, they experienced these things, and they stood faithful and courageously for God. You know, I just think that I just worry, though, if the church were under persecution, would the church stand firm? Would we die for what we believe? Or would we be, you know, would we take the way out that said, you know, you won't eat the pork, okay, we understand, but here, eat the meat you can eat, but people will think it's the unclean thing. I mean, that would be, okay, well, God, you know, this is a way out. I'm not compromising. I'm doing what is right. But you see, he wouldn't do it because of the way it what? Looked. I don't want to even give the appearance of caving in because of the younger people. I just want, God, give us courage. And we've got to live courageously now if we're ever going to live courageously in the future. I mean, it all starts now. It's little things, you guys. Little courageous acts, little acts of integrity. All of these things, we take a stand now, and then, you know, we're ready to take a stand letter. But the most offensive thing Antiochus did was to desecrate the holy temple. On Kislev 25, Kislev is the month that we're in right now. It's November, December. And so in Kislev 25, 168 BC, after entering the temple, Antiochus removed the golden altar and he set up a statue of Zeus, the supreme god of the Greeks. And there he put it in the courtyard of the holy temple. Of course, I just have to, an aside, the face of Zeus was Antiochus's face. So he commanded the Jews to worship it. Come to the temple and bow down to this idol in the temple courts. On the birthday of Zeus, he also sacrificed swine to the Greek god. He sprinkled the blood of the pig. He went into the Holy of Holies and he sprinkled the blood of the pig all over the Holy of Holies. And then he took the broth from the pig, and he poured it over the holy scriptures, over the scrolls. Then he cut them up, and he had them burned. He was doing everything he could to desecrate all the things of God. Then he commanded the priests of God to eat the pork. And when the priests protested, he took them, and he tried to force it down their throats. And when he would force it down their throats and they wouldn't swallow, he had their throats cut. Kevin L. Howard continues, the shock, the horror, the nation reeled with severe trauma. The sanctuary of the Most High had been polluted and profaned. It had been desecrated and defiled. In the words of 1 Maccabees, it was, quote, laid waste like a wilderness and trodden down. And as such, the nation was left utterly desolate. The temple was converted to a shrine of Zeus, and only swine were permitted for sacrifice. Antiochus forbade the practice of Judaism on pain of death. Children, as we said, were only to be taught to speak Greek, no Hebrew. Sabbath observance and the rite of circumcision became capital offenses. He aggressively sought to destroy all the Torah scrolls and forbade its study. Again, I want to read from Howard. He says, if Sabbath was observed or dietary laws kept or circumcision performed or scrolls of the law found, the whole family was put to death.
Babies were hung around their mothers' necks, and women were thrown from the walls of the cities. The line had been drawn, either assimilate or be annihilated. Become Greek and leave your Hebrew roots and leave your trust in the God of Israel, or be annihilated. Now, I'm going to say this right here. This also was the spirit of the Antichrist, because his desire was to annihilate the Jewish race, or being able to for the Messiah to come because there wouldn't be a lineage that could be traced back to the tribe of Judah. You see, it's still about 200 years from the birth of Christ. And so this is, again, Satan's attempt. I mean, first of all, he tried his first attempt to destroy the line of the Messiah was when Cain killed Abel. And by the way, according to Jewish understanding, Cain killed Abel on the 25th of Kislev, the same time of the desecration of the temple here. Year 47, I think, from creation is what they say. So Cain, then later we have Pharaoh trying to kill God's people, right? And of course, Satan, the spirit of Antichrist, is behind him, trying to destroy the Jewish people so the Messiah couldn't come. Then I'm just trying to run through this in my brain. Then you have Esther and Haman, the wicked Haman. You know, we have the book of Esther, the feast of Purim, and all of this. He tried to destroy the people of God, annihilate the Jews, again, because the Messiah is coming through the Jewish people. And then you have Antiochus. Again, he is a picture, as we're going to see, of the Antichrist, trying to destroy the people of God before the Messiah could come. And then, of course, you have Herod, who is attempting to do the same thing, when he had all the little babies killed after Jesus was born. But the Messiah had already come. You know, this caused those who wanted to study the Torah to have to do it secretly. And next week we're going to look at what they did. But I can tell you this much, that often they would gather in small study groups. And if the Syrian guards approached, they kept this little top that would spin. It's called a dreidel. And they would keep this dreidel, and if they saw the Syrian soldiers coming, they'd quickly hide the scroll, and then they would pull out the dreidels, and it would look like they were playing this. It's basically kind of a kosher gambling game, is what it is. And that's why today, when you celebrate the festival of Hanukkah, there is this the dreidel is played. I mean, it goes right back to that. But after several years of this reign of terror, God intervened. Thousands of Jews resisted Antiochus Epiphanes' enforced attempts to Hellenize them, and they refused to follow Greek practices, and they wouldn't bow down to the Greek gods. They were hunted, and thousands of them were murdered. But in the tiny village of Modin, which is about 17 miles northwest of Jerusalem, there was a pagan altar built to Zeus. Again, I'm just going to let Kevin Howard tell us the story. He says, the townspeople were assembled and an aged priest named Mattathias was singled out of the crowd. He was ordered to offer a sacrificial pig to the Greek gods in honor of Antiochus. Mattathias, head of gray hair, was visible, testimony to the respect that he carried with the people. He was the great-grandson of Hasmon, a descendant of Jehoiarib of the first division of priests, who's also the father of five sons, John, Simon, Judah, Eleazar, and Jonathan. But now all eyes were upon him. What would he do? Never, he replied with defiance. At that moment, an apostate priest approached the altar, and he requested permission to offer the pig. The onlookers knew what would follow. After the sacrifice, they would be forced to eat its flesh in identification with the sacrifice. Indignation stirred the heart of Mattathias and erupted into violence. He ripped the sword from the hand of the Syrian officer and killed him. Rushing forward, he ran the sword through the body of the apostate Jew and left him lying on the altar. His five sons simultaneously engaged and slew the remaining soldiers in the commotion. Quickly, they pulled down the altar, knowing that severe retribution would be taken, they and the faithful of the city fled to the hills of Judea, leaving all possessions behind. And so the revolt began, an uprising against the enemies of the one true God. Mattathias said, listen, I love this quote. He says, even if all the nations that live under the rule of the king obey him and have not chosen to do his commandments, departing each one from the religion of his fathers, yet I and my sons and my brothers will live by the covenant of our fathers. We will not obey the king's word by turning aside from our religion to the right hand or to the left. And I have to say what? Amen to a man like that. And he inspired the people. He says, we're not going to compromise. I don't care if the whole world compromises. And you know, I think Peter, you know, when he says, what would you have us do? Remember when he's being persecuted? What? You decide, is it better for us to obey a God or to obey a man, right? Well, he knows this. This is this whole story you're hearing. This is Jewish heritage. Don't think that, oh, this is something outside the Bible. So, no, this they all lived and knew. This was part of their heritage. This was a precious story. No, it's not inspired record, but it happened. Y'all following me? And this was something, this was their heritage. And anybody with Jewish heritage, this is your heritage. And those of us who've been grafted in, this is our heritage, to stand true and right with the living God and our Savior. Now, God, by his grace, helped the people to organize a revolt against Antiochus. Civilian freedom fighters led by Judah, his son, Mattathias' son, began to arm themselves with what little armament they had. Judah, he's also known as Judas, Judah Maccabee, or Maccabeus. By the way, the name Maccabeus means the hammer. Isn't that cool? The hammer. He led the revolt that eventually drove out the Greeks from the temple and Jerusalem and the country. Interestingly, though, the name Maccabeus is also an acronym for Mi Kamocho Baalim Hashem, which means, who is like you among the powers, O God? Maccabeus, who is like you among the powers, O God? And that was the battle cry of these freedom fighters. And though Judah had an army of not more than 12,000 men, and the Greeks had an army of up to 40,000 men, though Judah's army was poorly trained, if not trained at all, and he had little or no armament, and the Greeks were trained soldiers, and they had state-of-the-art weapons, God gave victory to the Maccabees, and the Greeks were forced out of Jerusalem, out of the land, and God granted victory over them. And the priests who compromised their faith, they were all slain. They were executed. And so 3 years later, on the very day that the temple had been desecrated, 25 Kislev, 3 years to the day later, the temple was rededicated and was cleansed. The altar was removed, which had been polluted by the pagan sacrifices, and a new one was built. They also restored and reconstructed the interior of the temple and its courts. They'd been hacked to pieces by the Greeks. They renewed the various sacred vessels, including the seven-branched lampstand, the menorah. The golden menorah had disappeared, you know. The altar of incense and the table of the bread of the presence. They didn't know what to do. I don't know if I should tell you this or not. Can I? Okay, this is cool. But I don't want to get into next week's teaching. Next week. Next week. But we're not even done with this one. Wait till you see what's coming up here in a minute. But they didn't know. I'm going to wait. I got to wait. Okay, just don't let me forget next week, okay? Now, how does this fit into Scripture? By the way, did I tell you this? That the first murder that ever occurred in human history, I told you that, right? According to the Greek, to the Hebrew tradition and scholars, happened on 25 Kislev, the year 47 of creation. Did you hear that? Yeah. Did I say that already? Oh, I did. Okay, maybe I didn't. I don't know. I've been talking this to the staff before the meeting tonight because I'm so excited. I said, listen to this. And so I can't remember who I told this to. Okay, now where are we? Daniel chapter 11. You say, what does this have to do with the Bible? You're just giving us this history. Yes, because you need this history to see the Bible fulfills its prophecies. Every word of God is true. And this ties in. This story of the Maccabees, this story of Hanukkah, do you know it ties into last day prophecy? You're kidding me. It ties into last day prophecy. And we as Christians know that. There's a secret that we as Christians know that maybe you don't know yet, but you will before you leave. Let's look at Daniel chapter 11, verse 31. Daniel 11 is probably the hardest chapter in the Bible to exegete. It's extremely complicated. I'm not going to do that tonight. But in the midst of this description of who will invade Israel and when, before it happened, the prophet Daniel describes the intrigues and all that will happen with different generals and kings and commanders that will invade Israel during and before and during this time that we're talking about. But it says, look at what it says. Here's the prediction that Daniel made hundreds of years before. It says, forces from him will arise, desecrate the sanctuary fortress, that's the holy sanctuary in the Temple Mount, and do away with the regular sacrifice. Isn't that what Antiochus did? Hello? Yes. And they will set up the abomination of desolation. What an abomination is? The abomination in the Old Testament, the abomination to a Jew is an idol. That's an abomination. The abomination of desolation was when they took that statue, that image of Zeus, and they put it in the Holy Temple. And as we read from Maccabees, I quoted from Maccabees, the temple was laid waste. Remember? It was laid waste. Exactly fulfilling what God said would happen to the temple. They set up the abomination of desolation. And that happened on 25 Kislev, 168 BC. The abomination of desolation was set up. Now look at Daniel chapter 12, verse 11. And he says, from that time, from the time that the regular sacrifice is abolished and the abomination of desolation is set up, there will be 1,290 days. I'm not going to get into that whole prophecy. I just want you to know that the Bible calls that event the abomination of desolation, right? What happened to Kislev 25, right? And it talks about something in the future. Let's look at Jesus' prophecy in Matthew chapter 24. If you want to know what's going to happen to the world, you go to what Jesus says in Matthew chapter 24. And he talks about what's going to happen in the end times. He talks about what's going to happen to Christian believers. He talks about what's going to happen to the Jews who don't believe in Jesus, who aren't completed. He talks about what the world is going to be like. Talks about how Jesus is going to come, and he's going to come once, and it won't be observed by all, but then he'll come back in glory, and we call that the second coming. And so there's a rapture, there's a second coming. But look at what it says in Matthew 24. Jesus brings us back to what we just studied. He says, therefore, when you see the abomination of desolation, which was spoken of through Daniel the prophet, standing in the holy place, let's pause. Do we understand exactly what that is now? Do you? Okay, you don't. What was the abomination of desolation that Daniel spoke about? Where am I? The wrong verse? Oh, I'm sorry. No wonder. Thank you. Verse 15. I'm thinking, oh no, I failed. Okay, 24:15. Therefore, when you see the abomination of desolation, which was spoken of through Daniel the prophet, it probably doesn't matter anyway. Do you understand what this means? Okay, you don't have to say yes if you don't. Okay. Daniel predicted what happened during Antiochus Epiphanes. Antiochus Epiphanes was a picture of the Antichrist. Daniel predicted that. Every Jew Jesus is talking about knows that. They're all observing Hanukkah, aren't they? Everybody knows that. And so he says, when you see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet, I got to stop here again. What do you mean when you see it? It already happened, right? So how can you see it? Well, it's going to be something future as well. When you see the abomination of desolation, which is spoken of through Daniel the prophet, standing in the holy place, let the reader understand. Don't you love that? Let the reader understand. Then those who are in Judea must flee to the mountains. Jesus says it's going to happen again. It's going to happen again. The abomination of desolation, Kislev 25, 168, is going to happen again in the last days. Reader, understand this. Jews immediately would understand. He's speaking to them, isn't he? To his apostles. They all got it. They probably were scratching their heads a little. But they're saying, really? It's going to happen again? When? I'm glad you asked. Let's go to 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. Way to the right in our Bibles. Keep going through Corinthians. Say hi to everybody on the way. 2 Timothy. No, that's too far. Sorry. Keep going. Not Thessalonians. I said hi to Timothy and I went too far. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. Oh, I got to start with verse 1. He's writing to these new Christians. He had only been with them for just weeks after they were saved, and then he had to leave. And so he's really proud of them for how quickly they've grown in the Lord, how they've come to know the things of God. But they were upset because Paul said that believers would escape the great tribulation. And they had been given a spurious letter claiming to be from Paul that said that the tribulation had already begun. Now understand this, they're being persecuted for being believers. And so Paul told them that the tribulation and great tribulation would be a time of terrible persecution, but he also taught them that believers would be caught up to be with the Lord before that would happen. So they get this fake letter claiming to be from Paul, saying we're in the tribulation, and so they are freaking out. Wait a minute, we thought we were going to be delivered from this time, right? And so now in chapter 2, verse 1, now we request you, brethren, with regard to the coming of our Lord Jesus and our gathering together to him, see, this is, he's answering their question, so that you may not be quickly shaken or be disturbed either by a spirit or a message or a letter as if from us, to the effect that the day of the Lord has come. In other words, this letter is saying, he says, let no one in any way deceive you, for it will not come unless the apostasy, the falling away, comes first, and the man of lawlessness is revealed, the son of destruction. The man of lawlessness, the son of destruction, is the Antichrist. Antiochus Epiphanes was a picture of him. He, verse 4, opposes and exalts himself above every so-called god or object of worship. That's exactly what Antiochus Epiphanes did, right? Exalted himself over everything. So that, look at what it says, so that he takes his seat in the temple of God, displaying himself as God. What did Antiochus do? Antiochus didn't even go that far. He just put an image of Zeus with his face on it, right? The Antichrist will be like the same spirit as Antiochus, only more fierce. He's going to come, and he's going to come into the temple. He's going to sit down, and he's going to demand to be worshipped as God. What does this mean? First of all, this is the abomination of desolation. What's the abomination? When an image was taken and placed into the Holy of Holies. Jesus said it's going to happen again. The Apostle Paul says, yes, it's going to happen again. And when's it going to happen? It's going to happen when there's a rebuilt temple in Jerusalem. He said, how do you see that? Because there's no temple right now for that to happen in, right? And there hasn't been. Once the temple was destroyed in AD 70, there has never been a temple built. But the Bible says there will be one because the abomination of desolation is going to occur, and it's going to be when the Antichrist is sitting in the temple of God. He will take his seat in the temple of God, displaying himself as being God. And as you read the book of Revelation, it says that he will demand that all worship him. He will persecute those who want to serve God and follow his laws. The church, of course, will not be here, but there will be a great revival among the Jewish people. As the Bible says, there will be 144,000 Jewish evangelists evangelizing all over the world. He says that there will be two witnesses. These two witnesses will perform great and mighty signs and wonders, and the whole world will watch. See, that couldn't happen until well, where is this all? Let's look at Revelation 11. And this all tied to Hanukkah, right? Hello? It's all tied to Hanukkah. Abomination of desolation, being cleansed, Hanukkah, you know, it's all tied to Hanukkah. Prophecy, last day prophecy, tied to Hanukkah. I'm excited. Revelation chapter 11. We know that there's going to be a temple rebuilt during the tribulation. This temple, it says in Revelation 11, there was given me a measuring rod. This is John speaking. The Lord's giving him the revelation. John says, I was given a measuring rod like a staff, and someone said, rise and measure the temple of God and the altar and those who worship in it. So, it's pretty clear there's a temple during this time. John, go measure it. But he's told, leave out the court which is outside the temple. Do not measure it, for it has been given to the nations, the Gentiles, and they will tread underfoot the holy city for 42 months. Well, I'm not going to, you know how easy it is for me to go everywhere. I'm just going to, all we're saying is, during the tribulation, there is a rebuilt temple. The Antichrist will be in that temple, and Jesus said it will be the abomination of desolation. It will be the last abomination of desolation. It will be like the one that Antiochus Epiphanes performed. It'll be like that, only it'll be worse. Yet the day will come when, just like on Kislev 25, 168, 165 rather, the Holy Temple was reconsecrated, rededicated, and that's where Hanukkah came from, the celebration. Even so, at the end of that time of tribulation, the Lord Jesus will come and he will cleanse this earth. And there'll be a time, you know, during the millennium when he sets up his kingdom. And during that millennial time, he will rebuild the temple. And the book of Ezekiel spends half the book of Ezekiel talking about that future temple during the millennium. Hanukkah prophecy. What happened in those years between the final prophet, Malachi, and the beginning of our New Testament, Matthew, is all so important to us as we see how it ties in now to last day prophecy. So, when our family celebrates the festival of Hanukkah, we remember these things. We look back and we say, oh Lord, we remember we want to live as courageous people. We want to be able to stand firm no matter what the persecution might be. We want to be courageous men and women, like Hannah and her seven sons, and like Judah and his brothers, and like Eliezer the priest. And we want to be godly men and women that would take a stand and not compromise what we believe. We see that God's word is true. As we look at Hanukkah, we realize that, Lord Jesus, you, on that time, you during that celebration, you said, you tied that celebration rather to Bible prophecy. And so when we celebrate it, we look back, but we also look forward and we say, wow, this time is coming when the Lord's going to return. The time is coming when there's going to be a terrible time of trouble upon this earth, but we're going to be delivered from that. Now, next week, I want to share with you another aspect of the festival of Hanukkah, and this will have to do all with Jesus and how he is the fulfillment of Hanukkah. Now, in order to do that, next week, I'm also going to share with you how the festival is celebrated. It's a lot of fun. It's a joyous time. It's relaxed. It's not like, you know, some of the festivals or the feasts of Israel that, you know, everything's kind of done this way. Hanukkah is not that way. For one thing, again, it was not declared to have to be practiced by God, but it was practiced by all Jews as a time of happy celebration. Part of the celebration of Hanukkah, well, it all revolves around miracles. Next week, I'm going to tell you the miracle of Hanukkah. It's fantastic. But it revolves around a lampstand that is unlike the seven-branched menorah that you usually see and the one that was in the temple. This is a nine-branched menorah, and it's called a Hanukkiah. Okay, it's just the nine-branched candelabrum. It's called a Hanukkiah. And the candles all symbolize something, all right? They are going to be lit during the 8 days of Hanukkah. I got to tell you more about this next week, okay? We are so out of time. Whoa, way over time. Whew. I just lose track of time. But what I'm going to tell you, okay, listen. Come back next week. You'd be crazy if you didn't. The best is yet to come, truly. How Jesus fits into this. But this is what I want you to think about. Next week, we're going to share how to celebrate the festival of Hanukkah. In order to do that, you're going to want a Hanukkiah. I mean, it's hard to do without one, unless I guess you can put candles in the sand or something like that, you know. But we have a supply, not a lot, not enough for all of us, but we do have a supply of Hanukkiahs available in the bookstore, and they've brought part of the bookstore out here in the atrium, and you can buy one. You say, oh, you're selling stuff? At the price that they are offering things, I could be selling stuff, okay? They're like, it's crazy prices. Now, in our family, each one of our kids has a Hanukkiah, because as they've grown up, we've always celebrated Hanukkah. It's a fun time, like I'm going to tell you more next week. But you want to have one of these, okay? You're going to want to celebrate Hanukkah. It's going to be fun. So they have them in the atrium. You're welcome to them because next week they will fly out. So I'm just saying, maybe you're saying, but I'm buying something and I don't know why. Trust me, if you don't want to do it, we'll take it back. Refund your money and give it to somebody who does next week, okay? So let's make that our deal. If next week you realize, why did I do this? We'll give you your money back. Is that okay? Okay, so such a deal. Oh, okay. Let's stand up. Oh. Why am I teaching this right now? Because Hanukkah begins Wednesday night before Thanksgiving. Is that awesome? So these 2 Wednesdays before that night, I wanted to teach on this. So if you want to be involved in that, you're all prepped, ready to go, understanding the Bible stuff, understanding the Jewish significance and how it ties to Jesus next week. So can you believe it? Thanksgiving evening, first light of Hanukkah. It's going to be really cool. Well, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. And may the Lord lift up his countenance on you. That means smile on you. And may he give you his peace and his special protection is my prayer for you in Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen. God bless you. See you next week, gang.